was loud, definitely racy, in your face,
boisterous, and superficial.
Kicks ass.
Nothing is taboo.
That's exactly what hard rock is all the collisions.
What matters is that they rock and they make sense and it connects with you.
Something that doesn't just go in your ears, it goes in your blood.
Heavy, hard, un-PC, in your face.
Open up a can of whoop ass.
Period.
This is VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock. I'm Carmen Electra. Sensitive singer-songwriters might thrill the critics, and teen sensations might rule the charts. But there has always been a place for those bands that make no apology for playing loud, raunchy rock and roll. And that's who we're saluting. The 100 greatest heavy metal, punk, grunge, and classic rock artists of all time. The list is the result of VH1's massive poll of hard rock musicians and journalists. Dave Grohl, Geddy Lee, and Ozzy Osbourne were some of the many great artists to cast their vote. In case you're just tuning in, here's a look at the acts you might have missed.
Quiet Riot,
Jazzman's,
Mountain Fantasy,
Meatloaf, Fugazi,
Yes, Lenny Kravitz, Black Crowes,
Danzig,
Rainbow,
Three to Four,
Tool,
King Crimson,
Horner,
Whitesnake,
UFO,
King Z,
Queensryche,
Dixie.
From the college town of Berkeley, California, comes our next group, a trio whose major label debut sold millions and helped to ignite a new barrage of pop punk bands.
Green Day, I love the band, no fat in the band, I love the trio. I love having guitar, bass, and drums. I love how short and to the point it is.
I love the lyrics. You know, very fun. Anytime you can do self-effacing lyrics, I love that.
Sometimes I give myself bad dreams. Sometimes my mind trips on me. It all keeps setting up. I think I'm cracking up. Am I just paranoid?
Then they came along with that ballad, you know, with just the guitar. And I just went, wow, that is really good. It showed a side, showed a dimension that I didn't know these guys had.
It's something unpredictable, but in the end is right. I hope you had the time of your life.
I thought they had an extraordinary amount of energy. It seemed to me they were mixing like punk with kind of new wave grunge. Like they had a bit of a Nirvana tinge to them.
I think that Billy is just a prolific writer with great talent. Their style is a reference that a lot of other punk bands look to.
LA's original headlining hair bands, Rad combined a standard formation metal attack with a sleazy soft side to gnarl their way into metal infamy.
When I first met them, when they had first come up from San Diego in about 1982, they were as heavy as anybody coming down the pike.
Backed up their bad boy rock with plenty of sexual imagery and wrote songs that were hard edge and refreshingly tongue-in-cheek.
Heard Milton Berle in the video. They were great.
I define rap music as a different breed of animal, nice and nasty, safe sleaze. It's fun.
Stephen Pearcy is a good singer. Bobby Blotzer is an awesome drummer. But Warren DeMartino will always be one of rock's best guitar players.
It's good time music, and there's only one band that delivers rock and roll music, and it happens to be us.
His name is a combination of one of America's most loved icons and one of its most hated. An androgynous contradiction, which is shockingly accurate.
Every decade of this bad boy, I mean, it was Alice Cooper, then me, now it's Marilyn Manson, you know, I'm glad he's come around, we can go and walk out the street without getting persecuted and attacked.
Marilyn Manson, born Brian Warner, came to prominence with the help of Nine Inch Nails' Trent Reznor and brought his band of demonic disciples to rock's mainstream.
The first time I saw him, it was like the second coming of Alice.
It's a great idea, you know, a girl's name with a guy, a lot of theatrics. I wish I would have thought of that.
It would be so easy for that band to just be written off as a joke, and I'm sure a lot of people do because they can't get past the image. You know, you really got to look deeper because they do make good records and they do write good songs.
Under the makeup and the prosthetics, Manson's music was uncompromising in content, and his depraved decadence helped to put a fresh coat of paint on the face of glam rock.
He represents, in essence, the next generation, which is even more disenchanted and even more disconnected.
After the break, we'll turn the amps up to 11 and pay tribute to heavy metal's best dressed transvestites.
They were just hell bent on being really tough, but dressing in drag, which was a very, very wild thing.
VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock continues after this. Between movie roles in Sid and Nancy and The People vs. Larry Flint, this next band's fiery frontwoman helped push the boundaries of hard rock in the 1990s.
I am dog hard.
The thing about Hole is that, quote, they dominate the stage.
I think she's very dedicated and very driven, you know, wild kind of woman. There's all this energy.
She's got an ability to tap into those depths of despair and anger and depression that I think almost every single woman has felt in her life.
Oh, make me over.
I wish there were more women like her.
I'm all I wanna be.
You know, fighters.
Walk and study.
Warriors.
She can jump from genre to genre. Act for a while, model, dress up and look sophisticated. In your face punk. She can do it all.
I'm white trash. I didn't go to college. I just wanted to be a girl rock star. That's all I wanted to do. That's it.
Sometimes I'm just very entertained by how ludicrous she is and how she does what she does. When you strip away all of the scandal and all the tabloid stuff, you're just left with the music. There's great music. Bon Jovi's one of those bands that made three or four of the greatest rock singles of all time.
With their good looks and enticing blend of metal and pop, Bon Jovi became one of the most commercially successful and radio-friendly hard rock bands in the 1980s.
Valued and appreciated the authenticity and the integrity of John Bon Jovi. Songwriting capability, certainly his collaboration with Richie and the guys in the band.
I just admire John and Richie and everybody for again being part of the mainstay and the backbone of that kind of music.
I think people started to show the take notes that it was better than all of those other bands that looked like that.
In my wildest dreams, I never knew or thought that it would last as long, or it would be as big. I'm a cowboy on the steel horse I ride. I want it,
head of the line. It's my
According to legend, the band at number 75 was one of the most successful British heavy metal bands in history. Not bad for a bunch of unemployed American actors.
It's pretty.
Yeah, I like
it. What do you call this?
Well, this piece is called Lick My Love Pump.
Late 70s, early 80s, heavy metal seemed to the average onlooker like one big party. It took three comedians and a series of ill-fated drummers to reveal the not-so-glamorous side of hard rock.
Spinal Tap, I think, was a mirror of the worst aspects of the rock and roll business at that particular point in time.
People were trying to almost exist in the marketplace and use a lot of gimmicks and smoke.
Everything got more extroverted and wilder and flashier and glittery.
Spinal Tap just put the cap on it. When that movie came out, so many people looked at it and went, oh, God, that's me.
There's a little Spinal Tap in all of us, not being able to get out of the pods. I've seen it happen. Getting lost backstage.
First door you sign, authorized, personnel only.
Yeah.
Open that door, that's the stage.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Rock and roll.
Yeah. Rock and roll. Yeah.
Nobody show up at the autograph signing. I have seen it happen.
Stonehenge.
But Spinal Tap really got in and took the real rock band's ideas. I mean, they must have toured with them.
I don't think you could find a better parody of us. Pat Benatar's powerful voice and trend-setting style would make her one of the biggest hard rock females of the 80s.
I would say Pat Benatar made it because of her voice. You know, she had a very powerful, she still does probably have a very powerful voice.
After the success of Heartbreak, I thought, God, she's so sexy. And I don't know what was alluring to me about her. I think it was just the fact that she had a very different voice.
Driving classics like Heartbreaker and power ballads like Love is a Battlefield earned the singer 4 Grammy Awards and 6 platinum and multi-platinum albums.
Pat, it has, you know, those, that incredible instrument, that incredible, wonderful voice. We are young.
vocal range just really treated all of us music fans to some great music.
What is that? A Twisted Sister pin on your uniform?
Welcome to our show.
I really respect the Twisted Sister for what they were doing as far as what they stood up for, as far as, like, you know, they were just hell-bent on being really tough, but dressing in drag, which was a very, very wild thing.
Look really weird. Weirder than 80s fans look. We look weirder than that. And D was famous for saying this about himself, that he looked like Bette Midler on acid.
My early memories of Twisted Sister are just full-on rock and roll fun. And they were totally hilarious. And one of the best, most exciting live bands of all time, Twisted Sister.
Whether it has lightning bolts or a zebra skin pattern, nothing says 80s metal like circulation-stopping spandex. Thousands of viewers logged on to VH1.com to vote for just who had the tightest spandex in the business. Girl hits it big, and a guitar band crosses the color barrier.
One of the few all-black hard rock bands that managed to break the mold of expectations of what a rock and roll band is supposed to look like.
When we return to VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock. Combining a blistering sound with high-energy live shows, the band at number 72 emerged from the fallout of one of rock's greatest tragedies.
I really like the Foo Fighters. Their songwriting's really good, and their playing's incredible. It's that straightforward driving rock.
Fighters are great because they evolved out of Nirvana thing. Dave, what a great drummer. And then he puts the drums down and becomes the lead singer.
I admire what the Foo Fighters have done. You know, Dave Grohl coming out of what would be a tremendous tragedy and building something incredibly powerful.
Very satisfying kind of rock and roll, where every time they come on, you always find yourself turning it up.
Hey,
nice to see a band that can play like that. They can play plugged in, make funny videos, dress up like girls and all the stuff they do, and then be able to sit down with the guitars and play it. I think that's, you know, that's a band that's working hard and that it'll be around for a while. Southern rock band, the Stones, a lot of the bands from overseas wish they would have been poor white boys from the South.
Lynyrd Skynyrd's gimmick is our music.
Simplicity in the music, that the phenomenal talent of playing was just incredible.
In 1977, a plane crash claimed the life of three members of the band, including lead singer Ronnie Van Zant. After a 10-year absence, Skynyrd returned to performing in 1987, this time headed by Ronnie's younger brother, Johnny.
They were fantastic then, and with the original lineup, and I've played with them recently, and they're just as good now, if not better.
Freebird is one of the top five played guitar anthems of all time, you know, almost to the point of it being a joke.
If anyone ever yells Freebird at me again.
But a great song that will live forever. And this bird you cannot change.
They still, to this day, without the original money, sell out every show they play. And to me, that's, you know, people buy their albums because they like the whole album. Everybody knows a few of their songs, but the diehard fans have been there for years. And that's the epitome of music, Lynyrd Skynyrd.
In a classic case of being in the right place at the right time, the next group on our list was discovered at New York City's infamous music club, CBGB's, by Mick Jagger.
The whole thing had an energetic, kind of like in-your-face kind of attitude.
They were just one of those great stage bands with all of the dreadlocks running all over the place, and they were moving.
We are the children of that we can see.
They really felt like a throwback to the power bands, but had extra stuff going on. They had a real vibe.
They weren't coming on with a soul thing, even though they had a lot of soul. They were coming across more psychedelic. It's almost like some sort of Jimi Hendrix offshoot, which I thought was really hip.
One of the few all-black hard rock bands that managed to break the mold of expectations of what rock and roll is supposed to look like or what they're supposed to sound like.
Check this out.
They brought some great moments to rock and roll and makes you realize that the possibilities are endless.
It's been
interesting to watch Mustaine because of his roots with Metallica, to see where he took it to the next level. Megadeth had this very unique position in metal, simply by the way that they create their definitive style as nobody else like them.
Steve Adler, Guns N' Roses' original drummer, came busting through the door one day with Megadeth's record and going, listen to this, you know, listen to this. And it's like 9 o'clock in the morning and it's just blaring. I was like, wow. It was like intelligent speed metal. You know, it was very articulate writing going on. There was a lot of verbal expressions that were being conveyed in the lyrics. I thought, wow, you know, this guy's psychotic, but he's got a head on his shoulders.
Hello, me. Meet the real me. And my misfits way of life.
Megadeth is one of the last metal bands. Probably the best, one of the best rehearsed, most consistent metal bands. Very intensely purposeful. What they play.
Dave Mustaine was never kidding about what direction he wanted his band to go in, regardless. It was sort of against all odds kind of thing, which as the fads change and it's like, you know, different bands come and go, they're one of the bands that's still around.
Getting a live tape of Husker Du and just freaking out because they're just so raw.
It had all the energy that punk had. And the sort of who gives a f- attitude. It had that sort of poise and beauty, but it had the energy of youth. They made fantastic music. They were great musicians. And they made these really dense, beautiful albums that no one completely understood.
Husker Du is probably one of the first punk rock slash alternative rock bands that I ever was really into. The chemistry that Grant Hart and Bob Mould had together as songwriters was great. Husker Du means I will remember, and it's like, you know, something I'll never forget.
Even though our next musical group's style may not fall strictly under the heavy metal heading, their influence on every form of rock and roll assures them a spot on any rock list.
Welcome to the sleazeball lounge. I'm the biggest sleaze of them all. No, I'm really just kidding.
Inspired by American blues, singer Mick Jagger and guitarist Keith Richards formed the Rolling Stones in 1962. The band first broke onto the American scene in 1964 at the forefront of the British invasion. In the years since, they have become one of the most successful and longest-running acts in history.
I don't think we'd be here without the Rolling Stones. They rocked out American blues and turned it into something that I've never heard before.
Mick Jagger had attitude. He had the moves. The face. I mean, he could sing me the Yellow Pages and I would buy it.
Strong, and you're so sweet. You make me hard. You make me weak.
Keith Richards pretty much embodies rock and roll. He's a songwriter, he's a great musician, he's decadent, kind of walks it and talks it.
We make a beautiful change.
The Rolling Stones were the best garage band of all time. You could see the Stones in a bar. You could see them in an arena. It doesn't matter. They play the same every time.
Joan Jett's punk-influenced rock took the music industry by storm.
I think that the public, if they really want to see a successful band girl that can perform Madonna, there was Joan Jett.
Joan Jett is feisty.
Joan Jett is a survivor.
Joan Jett will come up and smack it in the mouth just when you thought she was finished.
Nonsense, I'm a bad girl, don't get in my way, I will hurt you kind of person.
Joan Jett and the Blackhearts struck gold with their 1982 cover version of The Arrows' I Love Rock and Roll. The track stayed at number one for 7 weeks, exposing the world to rock's new wild woman.
Joan Jett, she's probably playing right now down the street somewhere. And it seems to me like she's in it for the right reasons, which is to rock. That's about it. That's what rock and roll is all about, is surviving.
Next up, the birth of a highway anthem and a cult favorite from across the pond.
You know, they totally captured the Sturm und Drang, the bombast, the power and the glory of rock.
We'll continue counting down VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock. Stay tuned. Used a powerful combination of goth and metal to make a splash on both sides of the Atlantic.
The Cult's a great band because they were the first band to really take the atmosphere of the English movement and turn that into something that had the rock and roll backbeat behind it.
The Cult again just broke the mainstream of what you define as heavy metal music.
So with the Cult, it was definitely like they had personality, they had charisma, and they had a sound that was recognizable.
They're just being distinctive in their style and their approach.
The Cult set the stage for what was to come in alternative rock because they sort of made it cool to rock. When somebody makes something okay, it's like it opens a door and everybody walks through it.
They totally captured the Sturm und Drang, the bombast, the power and the glory of rock.
Come on,
Steppenwolf had recorded and toured throughout the mid-60s as the Sparrows. It wasn't until their music was chosen for the film Easy Rider in 1969 that they got their big break.
Born to be wild.
Wild is a classic biker song and the classic highway song. I always enjoyed that band.
When John said, "Damn, I'm the pusher, man," I mean, that was real.
I said, "Damn, damn, the pusher, man."
So there was a realness about Steppenwolf that I think made them great and unique.
I had you dreaming. Yes, yes, right between the sun machine.
They've got such a chemistry, you know, that when they get up on the stage there, it's like beyond just rock. It's an awareness that they have.
You still hear on the radio, and they still sound fresh. If it sounds fresh, even if it's old, chances are it was honest music to start with.
As guitarist Tom Scholz's Basement Tapes, Boston's 1976 self-titled debut became the fastest-selling album of the decade.
They made a hell of a record. Listened to it, wore it out, bought it again. It's a perfect record.
The first time I heard More Than a Feeling on the radio, I said, wow, where did that production come from? And of course, Brad Delp's vocals were phenomenal.
On that record were made with Tom Scholz's invention. Like, he did everything with this rock, and he had this whole thing where he didn't use amps. I thought, wow. You know, and they have this incredible signature sound.
Probably the cleanest rock and roll band I've ever heard. They have lots of great songs.
They definitely were a unique, original band.
The break, hard rock gets medieval on your ass, and some industrial strength metal.
Loud. The loudest band I've ever heard in my life. Look at that.
Loud, live, punk is frightful.
When we continue counting down VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock. In the 1980s, the band at number 62 became a founding force in a new brand of aggressive art metal known as industrial rock.
Show me something I don't know, show me something I can't use, push the button, connect the f***ing dots! Lie it through your teeth!
It takes bands like Ministry to shake things up and push it to the next level, whether it wants to go there or not.
I could stop if I wanted to.
No qualms with that. He does what he wants to do.
I'm not going to get into this thrasho, technico, cyber, new wave, sanitized, homogenized in a box, put it out 120 BPM, down your throat, out your ass, and onto the next platter, you know? It's like, I don't know, it's good. You know, hopefully, I think it is, or I wouldn't put it out.
There's no use trying to fight. Human sound can stand up to this. Loud enough to knock you down. Burn out.
Man, Ministry, they were really freaky. Playing opposite them on Loud Fuse was a real education. I thought it was an incredible show.
Jesus built my car.
loud. The loudest band I've ever heard in my life. This guy's just loud.
Loud live concert.
Frightful. I saw him play live once in 94.
It's like standing right in front of Bob Mould's amp.
They have gigantic bulges. I like that.
What we are looking at is good and evil, right and wrong.
Jethro Tull was probably one of the most musical bands of that era.
You could tell they sat in a cabin somewhere and worked on their music.
Back in 74, I first saw them in Los Angeles. They were absolutely amazing. Ian Anderson was so exciting, so majestic on stage.
He's in a unique category of being, not just because the instrument he plays, but being that wandering minstrel. He has a very hypnotic effect.
It's a strange combination of metal, Renaissance, folk music or something like that.
And the shuffling madness on the locomotive breath.
Involving a very different instrument like the flute made them very, very interesting. They had almost a Renaissance-y, medieval kind of character to the music.
That was the first time I'd heard the flute played, you know, with a hard beat like that.
When I was a kid, the biggest thing for me wasn't to be a rock star or get signed. It was to get into a band that was covering Jethro Tull.
That wraps up this hour of VH1's 100 Greatest Artists of Hard Rock. But don't throw away your earplugs just yet. We have 60 more artists to go. Stay tuned.